Hi, everyone. I'm Gary Knoll. Was there a spiritual meaning to the 1960s? And if so, what is its legacy today? To join us to discuss this is Tobias Churton. That's T-O-B-I-A-S-C-H-U-R-T-O-N. He'll be speaking from United Kingdom on Skype. Tobias is regarded as one of the world's leading authorities on Gnosticism and Western esotericism and spirituality. He's been appointed as an honorary fellow at Exeter University, which is in the United Kingdom. He holds advanced degrees in theology from one of the colleges at Oxford University. And earlier, he worked with the BBC on its documentary projects and produced the excellent BBC docudrama series, Gnosticism, which won the New York TV Festival Gold Award for Best Religious Series. He's written many books that are thoroughly documented dealing with the history of spirituality in the West. He is also a poet, a musician, and he's working on a dramatic project focused on William Blake. But his most recent book is The Spiritual Meaning of the 60s, The Magic, Myth, and Music of the Decade That Changed the World. It's a massive 600-page tome that covers perhaps all aspects of the 60s generation, both its pros and cons. His website is TobiasChurton.com. Nice to have you with us today, Tobias.
Very good to be here, Gary. Thank you for asking me.
I started my media and journalism career during the height of the 60s here in New York City. I'm now in my 52nd year, being on the air every day. And I remember the radical changes in lifestyle and politics and spiritual ideas and music and the arts that took place. In fact, one of the joys of the 60s that we haven't seen since, in fact, it stopped about 1975 at the latest, there used to be, let's say, unique parties. These were generally held on Park Avenue or Fifth Avenue, and there'd always be a spiritual person. There'd be an artist. There'd be a Native American, a world traveler. There'd be an intellect. There'd be all these different people coming together, generally one of each, and for about 20 people. And it'd be a wonderful evening. We'd have dinner, and then we would discuss issues depending upon who had done something that was rather unique or had perspectives. And they would guide the conversation, and we would all share our points of view or ask questions. And that's where I first met, and we befriended. We've been friends. We just celebrated 53 years of friendship. Peter Max, the artist, he's a very close and dear friend of mine. And at that time, I also, in fact, we had a conversation about it, and Peter said, for those of us who are vegans, and there were very few who were vegans, we consider that part of our spiritual journey also, and saw the sentient being as being too sacred. If something had a mother, you didn't eat it. There was never abuse. There was love and joy and celebration of that life. And we were perplexed, and we would have conversations about why is it we have no trouble abusing through factory farming a cow or a chicken or fish, but we would never think to do that for a dog or cat or bird. And the disconnect, the spiritual disconnect. So we had a lot of these conversations, and not just at these once a week, you know, get-togethers, but it was almost a 60s bohemian type of energy. Andy Warhol was a part of it. I knew Andy, but we were not friends. In retrospect, many lifestyles and even disciplines that have gone mainstream today started in the 60s. I would include all of alternative medicine, vegetarianism, such as what we're now seeing with starting with the macrobiotic craze, the New Age, non-conventional psychological theories. In fact, I had several friends. I don't know if you recall any of these people, but Martin Shepard, Dr. Albert Ellis, Dr. Carmi Harari, Dr. Alan Putterman, Dr. Lane Kahn, Dr. Donald Mullen. These were all close personal friends of mine, and we would hang out together. And these were the leaders of different psychological disciplines. And There was a lot going on with yoga and meditation, but again, it was not mainstream. It was just within the communities. And there was a joke that if you can remember the 60s, you were not there. Of course, that referred to all the drug use. Some of us didn't do drugs. I didn't condemn anyone who did, but I didn't see how I could better myself by doing drugs. However, many of us who were there have certain fond memories. I certainly do of those years, with a sense of nostalgia. And many might feel that something has started in the 60s has been lost now. Maybe it was a sense of optimism, trust, promise, renewal. And perhaps it is that which brings forth these feelings of nostalgia that can provide a clue for us to better understand what may have been happening spiritually at that time. So, please, in your research, what do you feel people are most nostalgic for when they think of the 60s? And can you associate that with any kind of collective spiritual impulse that may have taken hold of that generation in the society it was trying to build? The forum is yours.
Yes, well, I think the great thing about that, well, I'll start with a sort of slightly negative thing to start with, because I went back to revisit in the 60s, so I can remember it through the eyes of a growing and very aware child. And we migrated to Australia in 1966. We were there for 2 years, and a lot of my most vivid 60s type memories are of that period. And Australia was very much an awakening country at that time, and you had a kind of 60s experience that was almost purified of some of the more the psychedelicism, which all came later and went to Australia in the early 70s, in fact. But I went back to revisit some of these old haunts in April, 50 years after we left, and I have very fond memories of that time. And I went back and I spent nearly a month there, and you know, I was, where is it? Where's the place I knew? I went to a lot of the places physically. Many of them hadn't changed. Some of them had, obviously. But obviously, what was missing and what can never be re-grasped was that I was there in the 60s. And trying to decide what it was that made that so very special is part of the reason I wrote the book, is I could write and do write about the spiritual content of the 60s, of which there is an enormous quantity of information to glean. But what its meaning was is very elusive. There are as a rainbow of possible meanings you can draw from it. You can apply all sorts of myths to the 60s, and it comes up top. It answers any mythic question you put to it. The 60s is very responsive to mythology and to the sense of legend. And you mentioned nostalgia. Of course, everything was so many things were new and were being born, and this great expectation of things getting better. Things are getting better. You know, we got over the post-war period in the United Kingdom, and there'd been also a disappointment with the materialism in America, I know, in the 50s, which is also part of the mix. And suddenly the dam door seemed to open, and you can hardly not attribute this to certain major factors affecting young people's minds. I mean, the arrival of the Beatles can never be underestimated in its clarion call. It seems to coalesce so much that was already nascent and present in the world at that time, and suddenly gives it a great sharp focus. And the focus goes on to youth, and the youth was experiencing in that period directly, as it were, I think. I know we can only talk in general terms. We are talking about a decade, which is not a solid thing. But there was a crisis of authority. And the tremor of this crisis of authority has a very positive aspect if you're in a sort of university setting or college. It means that you can question things. There's a great amount of questioning going on, as you were just describing, an awful lot of conversation. What subject couldn't you discuss? Suddenly there was it seemed there were more freedom to discuss openly issues of sexuality and of the mind, which might have been much more suspect, and also of politics and ideals of the future and all the rest of it. So you have this crisis of authority going on. Nobody is prepared to listen to one voice. There are many voices, and this plurality of possible meanings becomes one of the features of the decade and one of the problems in trying to, if you wanted to say, well, the spiritual meaning of the 60s is this, you know. Well, if you see, say, the film Easy Rider, which I talk about a lot in the film because I think it's a very seminal, very important film. I don't think it's any accident that they've got a copy in the Smithsonian Institute as a national artifact of the United States. It deals with the spiritual crisis, about the meaning of it. As the song goes at the end of the movie that Roger McGinn sings, all they wanted was to be free, and that's the way it turned out to be. And you have this amazing shot of the helicopter rises, and on the left is a river, which is really nature, and on the right is the road. And of course, it's the road of Jack Kerouac. It's the road of the existentialist beatnik. It's the road of the folk loving jazz blues person who's on the road, who's broken away from one particular town. He's going somewhere. He's going somewhere else. But our heroes in the film Easy Rider find only death and opposition at the end on the road. So somehow have they chosen the wrong road? And that feeling of doubt has crept into the era, partly because I think, like all dynamic eras, you have to have two opposing forces to make a thing dynamic, rather like the old TVs, which had a positive and negative charge, and the electron goes through the middle, powered by two opposites. I mean, that's really the process of life. And I say in the book that, to my mind, the two pillars of the 60s were hope and tragedy. And there's a dynamic going on through the 60s where these two forces are working out a living phenomenon between them. In between these two pillars, we who lived in the 60s were growing. But it is very difficult to reduce that to a monism, to just the spiritual meaning was one of greater freedom, a greater understanding of liberty, a massive extension for some people, not all by any means, of areas of choice. But it was also a painful era, and for many people to observe at the time has its large elements of folly and disintegration. But with this disintegration and destruction also goes a great creativity. So it was exhilarating as a human being to be alive then. And if we talk about spirituality, not in the sense of church going or a set of dogmatic beliefs, but as a greater experience of being alive, a deeper level of consciousness and existence, there was, without any doubt, you can see the 60s as a spiritual movement, and not by any means a vain or unsuccessful one. You mentioned things like alternative health. That's one of many things which were seeded in the 60s and which have borne fruit. I mean, the whole environmental Earth's planetary consciousness thing is very much part of it. I think one of the things that makes it a decade to be reckoned with historically is that it was perhaps the first decade, conscious decade. People were more aware that they were actually in this decade. And I think a lot of that you can lay at the door of President Kennedy, who says at the outset of the decade, he says it was the America's intention to put a man on the moon before the end of the 60s. And that really defines the space. And it defines this space, this infinite space, in a way, in a most extraordinary way. Never before had a decade begun with such an extraordinary statement of faith. We are going to put a man on the moon, something never even envisaged beyond the pages of fiction and science fiction and so forth. It's going to be a reality in which everybody's going to share. You're going to see it and be part of it. This is going to be an inheritance for the whole world. And I think that that going into space, literally going to the infinite, going to the stars, going into territory which historically was always the domain of angels and creative powers beyond man. Man was going to make a link with this in a very, very direct way. This missile, as it were, this rocket is not going to cast a nuclear war and shadow over mankind. This rocket's going to go beyond the limitations that were previously regarded as ineluctable and unbreakable. And I do think it that is the great metaphor of the 60s, is this rather violent oil, petrol-fueled, it wasn't a petrol, I know, this amazing projectile with all the hopes of the world going up in it, and it was going up regularly. This shot in the planet was happening on such a regular basis, with enormous velocity. You get a sense of it from the movie, the James Bond film, You Only Live Twice, where as the movie moves to its climax, the number of rockets going into space increases. Now, as rockets were going into space, people were going into inner space. There is this other dynamic of the 60s where you have people in universities to start with were gaining experimental knowledge of psychedelic compounds, some of which had been under research, peyote, obviously. And this all combines with the music, with the massive expansion of television and its range of subject matter. And of course, the rock and all of that. So I can't remember your original question, but I hope I've sort of gone over it somewhere in that effusion of mine just now.
You have, Tobias. Thank you. I appreciate those insights. Some people are saying that with the younger generation today, meaning the post-millennials, much of the 60s may be reemerging. The 60s music, notably the Beatles that you just referenced, early Dylan, most of the psychedelic bands are making a huge comeback in the younger generation. And if anyone goes on YouTube to play some of the older 60s songs, frequently in the comments, you'll find kids in their teens and early 20s stating how lucky we are to live during those years and how they wish they had been there also. And what do you account this to? And do you have anything to do with the sense of freedom then in your writings and understandings, like a spiritual liberation that people felt then and then is making a resurgence today in younger people, who many of whom are lost, that they don't have a clear identity of who they are, what their role in this world should be, how they should relate with others on one-on-one, what are the principal important issues of their life that they should be addressing. In effect, if you take a lot of the kids, and we're talking about over 180 million parents and their children represent the professional class. Richard Gale, who you've spoken with, our executive producer, is also a scholar. And we did the research using the most current federal statistics. And boy, it blew me away, because I was of the belief that we had around 17 million professionals. No, we have 71 million scientists, let's say doctors, nurses, teachers, people who, you know, engineers, lawyers, architects. You start listing all the people with an advanced education today, you're 71 million. Add in their family, and you're over 181 million. That's 60% of the American population. Now, they are the policymakers and opinion leaders, many of whom grew up during the 60s. Many are baby boomers. And so when these people, if they stay strictly careerist, their children don't understand the significance of the 60s, because it's all about career, possessions, where you stand in society, how you can be deferred to, how you can get things, and no sense of self. I wish that every young person meaning from 18 to 35, could have a daily listen for a month or two of Alan Watts. You're familiar with Alan Watts. I consider him one of
the important
voices.
Sure. Well, I mean, I can answer your question quite succinctly in a way. Sorry, are you there? Hello?
Yes. I'm here.
Yeah.
We're here.
I actually wrote the book specifically for my daughter, who was 16, I think, when I first mooted it. And she had started buying vinyl records of the Byrds, the Beatles, the Rolling Stones, the Who, Bob Dylan, all these things off her own, very much in distinction to what many of her school friends were listening to, which was the usual stuff of today, a large amount of rap and rhythmic stuff. Intrigued by this, and I was very happy to at last we've got something we can really talk about and share with a sense of abandoned fun that, you know, is no great. When I said it was thinking about her that made me realize that her view of the 60s was a very strange one to my mind, because it was so focused on the music and the psychedelic aspect, which was a very small part of the reality of life in the 60s. And I wanted to say to her, I said, well, it wasn't all like that, you know. It wasn't all a lot of people having a great time. There were a lot of people having a great time, but there was a great deal more to it, and I think you'll find it. Anyway, we talked about it, and she said, well, that's one of your books I will read, which for me was quite a delight, because I don't write them with the thing, you know. Normally, she's like so many of her generation. They don't seem to like books at the moment. Perhaps it's the kind of books that they've been acquainted with that's put them off books. I don't know. But they've become all very telephone and mobile oriented and internet oriented and all the rest of it. But so I wrote it for her, and I wrote it for her generation. I think they're called millennium children. I mean, she was born in 2000, which, of course, in the 60s was really the way out future. 2000, we were sending manned missions to Mars. And I think this is to answer the question of why they like the 60s. One of the things I believe happened is I think many aspects of the 60s were more modern than our so-called modern civilization today. I think in many respects our Western civilization has gone backwards and has retreated from the horizon that became visible at the end of the 60s, and the children naturally miss it. I think they've been they're aware of the very fact that they're able to look back. I mean, I certainly, when in the 60s, didn't look back to the 1920s and say to my parents, well, the 20s was pretty amazing, wasn't it? There were roaring 20s, and there was anarchy on the streets of Chicago, and there was, you know, mad jazz dancing all over the place and speakeasies. And, you know, I did the glamour of the 20s, which was enormous at its time, didn't mean anything to myself or anyone I knew in the 60s. Whereas for a child born in 2000 to look back on the 60s as something they'd like is almost a historical phenomenon in itself. This period has become a kind of legendary holy grail, and it hasn't taken very long. Okay, you can say, well, a lot of it's marketing. They're reselling these old albums, but nobody asked to buy them. you can put anything you like on the market, but if there's no appetite for it. The appetite is very real and very strong. The children, when I talked to my daughter, what she got out of it, and I think she's in some senses representative, was the sheer color audacity, the sense of liberty, the sense of whimsicality. She adored the movie the Beatles made, The Magical Mystery Tour, which at the time was panned, as regarded as rubbish in 1967 when it came out. But she said, no, it's very spiritual. She said, it gives her a sense of a greater depth of sensitive life. So I think I think this description of the generation has lost. Many of them are. Many of them were in the 60s also, but they had something to cling to. They haven't got much to cling to now, but lectures from people telling them how to get jobs, how to keep the job, how to make sure they keep the job, and how to get on in the job. And it's very much like the 50s. Do you remember that film, The Graduate? With Dustin Hoffman, comes out of college, and the film came, was made by Mike Nichols in 1967, and he comes out of college and he's somewhat confused, and his parents invite him to a party, and he meets one of his father's friends who takes him aside as if he was a sort of a patriarch and goes, son, I've got one word to say to you, boy. Plastics. Get into the industry. And that sort of kind of, oh, That's the road to an income, to being able to pay your medical insurance, being able to have a decent holiday, and so on and so forth, and maybe a condo down in Florida or something like this. This material thing is what is being offered to young people. And the only spiritual knowledge many children get is through conventional churches, which, as we well know, anybody who's gone into this field, spiritual religion is for many people not satisfied by conventional religion, because conventional religion largely has an ethical moral basis and moral message, but it doesn't have a spiritually liberating one in the sense that we understand of authentic individuality. It's highly conformist. Behavior, look, and attitude must conform if you want to be okay with the big G. Whereas the spiritualities that began to flourish in the 60s were much more oriented towards personal authenticity and having your own vision and your own dream of things and your own interpretation. And the idea of being said, well, I believe these five things and that's going to get me into heaven, nullifies life to an extent. What is life? What's the rest of life for? It's a sort of long examination before, if you get through the exam, you're going to spend a lifetime in God's eternal holiday camp. Terrific. And that exhausts the meaning of life on earth. I think not. And I think the conception of life on earth that people are getting through the modern media is so narrow and so soulless that the 60s, by comparison, seems a positive oasis, regardless of the historical realities of living in it. I wanted in my book very much to give a sense of how it really was to be alive there, at least through my eyes, undrugged eyes, unblinkered eyes, a child's eyes, but also what is really of value in that period of great value. And what I discovered was an almost endless tale of creativity, dynamism, and vivid personalities. You watch a chat show today, you're longing for somebody really interesting to speak. People are so dull, and that the politicization of speech, the restriction on what you're supposed to be allowed to say, the so-called correctness, which is, you know, I don't want a policeman in my head telling me what I should say, what language I should use, how I'm supposed to interpret the universe, thanks very much, and how I'm supposed to stay in with my peer group. I'm not afraid. Being of that era, I'm not afraid of oppressing or offending and all this sort of stuff, because we had a sense of humor and you could laugh. There was so much more joy in being. Now, when the joy is gone, as Laurie Anderson said in one of her old songs, when love is gone, there's always justice. When justice is gone, there's always force. And when force is gone, there's always mom. Hi, mom. In other words, the more pinned up we are with ideals of correctness, the more impossible it becomes to have a free or beautiful experience at all. And it's just, you get, these are the things that I think attract young people to the era. The other thing is the sheer quality, obviously, of the music. The rock music attained unimaginable heights with some of the better exponents. There was a lot of trashy pop music in the 60s. There was a lot of boring commercial stuff. But all of that, leaders of innovation in sound and electrical impulse music, Jimi Hendrix, Bob Dylan, the Beatles, Rolling Stones, the Byrds. I mean, there was so much stuff. Every album coming out was seemed like a step forward from the other. The sky was not the limit. And so all those things can be enjoyed purely aesthetically today. Whereas the classical music of the 60s that was coming out, and some of the jazz, not all by any means, was by contrast, was rather conservative, reactionary, and a little afraid. But the energy was definitely with the youth. Most of the leaders of these bands had been to art college, and I think that was another fascinating part of the period, was the influx to youthful minds of concepts of art and creativity, the dynamism of youthful vision, of childlike perception, which was a vital part of the era. This stop trying to be your old man, you know, don't have to follow the man with the beard, you know. There was this idea of that the man is really just somebody who wants to put you somewhere. Modern society treats people very much as if they were an inconvenience, if only we organized our capital more effectively, we could do without all these people. There's such a, they don't half get in the way, don't they? There are all these people everywhere. Oh, I don't like that. I want to live in complete isolation from these people. I want to live on a gated estate, separate from, because what are people? Well, they commit crimes, they don't wipe their bottom, and they sort of, generally, they're a nuisance, and there are too many of them. So what do we need? We need a war. Yeah, get the drift of where I'm heading with that.
I appreciate your free flow of thought there. I came up with something recently, and I'd like to see if you have anything in your own background that would align with it or not. I went to a reunion of my high school, and I had an opportunity to speak probably with about 70 people during the whole evening. And what I found was most of these people, the vast majority, did not participate in the 60s or the 70s. They didn't participate in the sexual revolution, the feminist revolution, the back-to-the-earth revolution, the rock revolutions, the very things that you've written about and are discussing, and those of us who grew up, there was only a small percentage. And then I remember Dr. Elaine Kahn, a wonderful thinker. She was a psychologist from Columbia University. And she said, Gary, she had just done a major study and found that only 3% of the American population's heterosexuals and 3% of the America's gays participated in the sexual revolution. And I would have thought it was much higher. And she said, it's only in... She said, Gary, imagine that you're in a drive-in movie and you walk in front of the camera. Suddenly you're going to look 60 feet high. You're going to be projected on a screen, but you're only 6 foot one. She said, the media was so focused on certain aspects of the 60s that it made it seem like everybody was participating, but most people were simply passive spectators. And that brings me to what many sociologists have noted, that what we call the 60s culture was rebellion against what was being called the American dream, and that American dream was being lived by the greatest generation, our parents who went through the Great Depression and World War II and then helped rebuild Italy and Germany and France and Japan, etc., and most importantly the United States into the world's leading nation. However, the roles of men and women were sharply defined, and there were strong expectations on how people should contribute to society. And you were reminded by your church members how to act, by the people where you work, plus your own familial background. On the other hand, I would say most of the boomer, my generation, did not embrace the radical visions that were emerging. We need to remember that it's the boomers also who created the Wall Street and Silicon greed machines that we see today. If you look at the top people in the world as far as wealth, 90% are baby boomers. That we all grew up in the 60s, the vast majority. Only a few are older, like Warren Buffett. And as a result, it can be deceiving. One could say that these people sold out some of the better values of the 60s, which offered women's liberation and civil rights that were going on at that time, and caring for the poor. But then they were never really a part of that revolution in any spiritual values in the first place. And when I asked people, what did you do during the 60s and 70s? They just went right to school or to work, got married, had their family. They watched everything and read about things, but they never participated in anything. And I'm talking about every single person I spoke to from my generation. And what's interesting is the five people from my high school class who did get out there and did participate, they burned themselves out. They did everything. And they were those kind of people that were kicking and screaming and laughing and celebrating right off the edge of life. They would be alive today if they had balance in their life, including spiritual, but they were not afraid to participate. And they had, and everybody talks about the person that participates. Nobody talks about the person that spectates. And you never talk about a ball game the next day and talk about the people sitting beside you in the stands and where they work and what they were wearing and what they think about. And we lose perspective of how few people really participate in making the world what it is today. And so when you look back, you look at Bill Clinton and Obama, not Obama, but some of these people were not radical, but they were following the trajectory of the greatest generation, of what the greatest generation expected from youth, and those are the ones that got politically involved. Therefore, we can put the 60s into a greater perspective and show how it is not monolithic in any way. And it was a time that encompassed many contradictions and oppositions and different lifestyles that were not necessarily compatible with each other. Your thoughts?
Well, I couldn't agree more with that. I think that I make this point at the book from the very start and trace it, that the 60s, if you think it was a psychedelic party, was a very remote party. I think you ever see the film Midnight Cowboy, made in 1969 with John Voight and Dustin Hoffman. At one point, these are two guys who are really at the very bottom end of society. They've got absolutely nothing. They're living in a burned out shell of a place with no water, no heat and all the rest of it. And they're invited to a kind of Warhol-esque party in New York. And they sort of go up these stairs, the doors open, bang, and there's the 60s, pulsating walls with paisley shapes on the walls and music and dope smoking and people on acid and all this stuff and girls in exotic costumes. And then they're back on the street an hour later and it's snowing and they're cold and they haven't got a buck between them. And I think a lot of what my daughter's generation would think of the 60s was what was going on up those stairs. Whereas for most people, as you say, they were consumers. The 40s and 50s had produced this mass consumer society. And it took the ingenuity of advertisers by the end of the decade to commandeer the 60s radical thing and turn it into something that could be sold. I'm thinking of things like the Coca-Cola advert of 1970 with a lot of young people on the edge of a cliff singing, "We'd like to teach the world to sing." And it sounds, angelically positive. But it took them a long time to get there. But, of course, they can't do it without Coca-Cola, you know. So it was co-optable. All this energy and creativity was co-optable into the system. Now, when I said that in the movie The Graduate, he goes to the party and the man says to him, "Plastics." Well, you can imagine he'd said that to other young men who thought, "Yeah, I fancy that. You mean I get the car? Yeah, I'll get the car. Do you mean I'll get the, you know, you're going to get this? You're going to go, yeah, oh, I'll go for that. You know, I'm not like some of my friends." So creativity has always been a minority sport, and spiritual movements are always created by two or three gathered together in my name, as Jesus put it. So we can't judge the era by the activity of the many. That's for sure. I mean, that's always the fallacy of any democratic ideal, however it's expressed. The many need leadership. And that was a problem in the 60s, was who do you follow? But we know that most people in the Western world were fairly conservative, troubled by things that were happening, probably a little bit disturbed by rioting, streets, demonstrations, and would find it unpalatable. What is interesting is after this period of time, people have forgotten the normal, and the abnormal has come through with quite a lot of meaning attached to it. I mean, I asked two old friends of mine who are about probably your age now, who were mature and working in the 60s. And one of them, I said, "Well, what do you remember of the 60s? I said to one chap. And he said, "Oh, I remember we used to go to this pub in Sutton Coldfield, which is English Midlands. And on a Friday night, you could leave with somebody else's wife." That's what I remember. It was sexual freedom. And I asked the other friend, they knew each other in that period. I said, "Well, what do you think when you think of the 60s? He said, "Well, peace and love." He said, "Peace and love. That was new. The long hair, the peace and love." He said, "That was totally new. There was none of that beforehand, and that's what I remember it for." So there's two people who've known each other all their lives, same age roughly, reflecting on the same time in a small part of the English Midlands. So for sure, I think if we start to think that the whole world was engaged with this search, absolutely not. There were epicentres. It wasn't even all London. There were only bits of London that were really 60s as we understand the word. But I'm also interested in the book in all the other aspects of the 60s anyway that weren't the psychedelic. I'm also interested in the broad cinema, what was on in most people went to see, what most people watched on television, it's concerned with also people for whom the Bible was still the symbol of absolute authority, that I'm very interested in that. And it's the book is called The Spiritual Meaning of the 60s. I look at it from the idea of industry. There's a lot on plastics and the development of robotics and the new industries that were emerging in the 60s, new materials, and what they also tell us about the spiritual meaning of the 60s. So this is not a history of rock and roll. There are many books on that. There's a lot of rock and roll in it, but it's from a very fresh and very focused perspective.
There are three separate issues I would like to address. One is how the media, and I don't say that this is somehow with any intent to discredit or deceive, it's just that when they focus upon something that is exceptional or different, we then can't get the perspective that this is not normal for everyone. And I looked during a period in the 1970s at how much was being played out about Studio 54 and the disco scene. And I was fortunate because two of my friends owned 80% of the nightclubs, Bonds, New York, Infinity, the Underground. And these were the hot spots. The other was Starlight Cafe, and the final one was Studio 54, and I was not friends with Steve Rebell and Ian Schrager, who owned that. And on any given night, and I did the math on this, is partly how my geeky mind works, I counted and asked the people at each of the clubs, how many people come here in a night? How many nights a week? How many of them are repeat people? And it came to where on any given night in New York City, you had about 21,000 people going to nightclubs, disco clubs. But you had 21,000 Chinese restaurants in New York. You had within 50 miles, you had 20 million people. So when you look at the percentage of a population that's actually going out on a regular basis and partying and dancing, it's under 0.01%, and yet you would have thought everyone was doing it. That was one perspective, that somehow when the media pays too much attention to something, we think that it is far more common than it is. Also, I was at the Woodstock. I went to the reunion also, and at the reunion, there was a very interesting phenomenon. And that is, they tried to recreate the first Woodstock. Now, these are much young. These are the X generation, and they wanted to create what our parents went through. And so there was a little tiny area, probably about 50 feet by 50 feet, where it was all mud and water, and so people would go sliding in the mud. And most people were drugged out, vomiting. There was none of the exuberance and energy. The performers were just angry. It was in their energy. It was a very depressing place when people tried to duplicate something that was so
You can't do it from the outside.
You can't, but I watched them try, and yet the media, guess what? When the television crews went there, they only focused on people laughing and, you know, taking a bath in a tub or sliding through the mud. Or up on stage. They didn't look at the 99% of it that was not having a good time and were sick.
Image.
And then I went out to Haight-Ashbury with my first best-selling book, and it was just as it was beginning, and saw how people were hanging out and wearing the outfits. And then when people tried it later, they could wear the outfits, but They didn't have that exuberance, that come up and have a smile on your face. And one last thing. During the 1960s, I rented a space at 81st and Broadway, which is now a Staples store. It was about, I'm guessing, 10,000 square feet. And part of it I devoted to a place where anti-war people could come and quietly, secretly, do work on doing the posters and writing script so that the people who were out on the street could have, you know, the artistic and some of the philosophical expressions. And that was going on for years. But also the largest space there was for artists that I had met downtown on Bleecker Street who were very talented but having a rough time surviving financially. So I let them have their workspaces for free. And providing the payback was, you don't pay me rent. And I even had a vegan restaurant up on 108th and Broadway, the Fertile Earth. But you have to do something for society. And you have to show me that you're making it a better world for someone who has less. And some would do it, some wouldn't. That was the payback. But every day when I went in, I could just see that the smiles, the happiness of artists, with each one with a different background, sculpting, painting, drawing, whatever it was. And they were just happy people because they were creating things that no one had created before. It was the first of things. And I felt, wow, you know, wonder what people are going to think. Mm-hmm. And then I also remember I had a farm upstate at the time called the Fertile Earth Farm. It was the first organic co-op in New York, in fact, on the East Coast. And about 50 people would live up there who were homeless at a time. Hundreds of people lived up there over 15 years. And we would also grow crops and bring it into the Fertile Earth restaurant. But also some of the artists, they would go up there on the weekends and just be close to nature and swim in the ponds. And that's where people started to learn that you could get out of the drug scene and detox and reenter with your unique talents, but with a clean body and a deeper understanding on the spiritual level. And Shyam Bhatnagar, who brought chakra psychology and chakra everything to the United States. Chakra didn't exist in our vocabulary or nomenclature before he came. I just spoke with him this week, and he's 84 and doing great. And he was helping people learn how to breathe, and Ranky Shankar, they played together. And there was this innocence, exuberance, and creativity and renewal. There were people who were getting out of the drugs. They tried it, and it had hurt them. They were getting back their careers. They're two very famous people. They both had platinum albums, who detoxed for 6 months up at the farm. I won't mention their names. And the one who went public with it was Jerry Rubin, and he was happy to talk about his rejuvenation and his new beginnings. But we don't have that today, and maybe we need that today. We need places where artists can go without worrying about paying rent and focus upon their art. We need places where people can cleanse and detoxify without being criminalized or stigmatized, where they can also, there's a spiritual quality where they can not just renew themselves, but renew themselves with a purpose that's greater than simply avoiding pain and getting into some artificially blissful state. We need a place where people can write critical essays and articles without being suddenly on being trolled to death or being ostracized or censored by the larger platforms and such as Facebook and Google and Twitter, which are banning people who you would never believe should be banned because they're not saying a thing that's wrong. They're simply being critical of someone in society. So the things that I personally participated in the 60s and still do today, they have been lost. And I believe that we need those more than ever today. Your thoughts?
Well, I think you've said so many things. I just want to tick and say yes, 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 yes. I remember in 1983 writing a poem, and the line at the end, I think, was, "The computer cottage is an electric prison welded in the fear of vision." And this was long before the internet had even been thought of. This increased computerization and putting people in rooms relating to the world through a computer, as in fact I'm doing with you now in a way, would eventually lead to not a greater vision of life, but a much more compressed one, because there's no spiritual meaning in it. And what we need, as you say, is spiritual meaning. And I think that's what people can see, young people particularly, who are unabashed, see that there's something in the 60s that they haven't got, and that isn't an easy thing to get. And you can't get it out of a record. You might get it through looking through a piece of music or a work of art, but this needs to be cultivated, as you say. And there is very little ground for cultivation of this. Even that I'd spoke to very good artist friends of my own who were active in the 60s when they were students starting, and they're quite perturbed that people even go into art now, not to find themselves or to renew a vision or to express a vision, but because of the material value of what they might produce and what it would sell, and whether you can have a career in art. And of course, in the 60s, the people who were making a difference weren't too bothered about careers. We'll leave that for another day when we have to. So yes, the contrast between our own times and the 60s show up the weaknesses of our time in a very big way.
Well, I appreciate these insights, and especially the depth of how you've taken them in your new book. And my hope is that people will give themselves the opportunity to read something that not just reminds them if they had a chance to be there, and that, but also to appreciate the best or worst of what we experienced, because it was not all happy roads. The book is called The Spiritual Meaning of the 60s, The Magic Myth and Music of the Decade That Changed the World. The author, Tobias, T-O-B-I-A-S, Churton, C-H-U-R-T-O-N, a leading Gnostic and esoteric and spiritual philosopher. And we appreciate you being on today, and we look forward to our next discussion.
Lovely. Thank you very much, Gary.
Mother, mother, there's too many of you crying. Brother, 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 there's far too many of you dying. You know we've got to find a way to bring some loving here today. Yeah. Father, Father, we don't need to escalate. You see, war is not the answer, for only love can conquer hate. You know we've got to find a way to bring some loving here today. Oh, picket lines and picket signs. Don't punish me with brutality. Talk to me so you can see. Oh, what's going on? Judge us simply 'cause I'm